Hello again. Welcome to another Contacts with Conway. I'm Martin Conway, and today I'm in conversation with Maria Walker. Maria is a clinical instructor at the University of Houston in Texas, and today she shares her views on the possible causes of that perennial problem with scleral lenses, midday fogging. If you would prefer to watch this video with subtitles, please click on the cog in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen and select your preferred language.
Obviously the big issue for most practitioners and patients alike is going to be this curse of midday fogging. Perhaps you give us your views and your expertise on that, Maria.
Yeah, sure. So it's definitely probably the most common complaint apart from handling issues. I think it's definitely that two-week follow-up. Patients are going to start to experience the blur of midday fogging. So there's two ways that it can occur, and sometimes it occurs kind of as both. But some people will put their lenses in the morning, and within 10 minutes, it just feels foggy. Like you're just looking through like almost a cloud, some people will describe. But there's a few different ways that people will describe it. But when they put it in and it gets cloudy immediately, and actually you have to troubleshoot it a little bit at that point, because if it gets cloudy really quickly, you also have to wonder if the lens itself is wetting properly. But once you've troubleshooted through all of that, and then they finally come into the office and you can see the actual debris that develops in the tear reservoir, and that's what we're referring to when we say midday fogging, is literally just debris accumulates in the fluid
reservoir. It's not on the outer surface of the lens, and it's not on the cornea, it's actually debris underneath the lens.
Right. It's within the lens itself. And so patients will often maybe confuse it. Like I've had patients come in and think they were having midday fogging, but really it was a lens wetting, because there's a lot of stuff online that says if vision's blurry, it's midday fogging. So it is important for the practitioner to really ask important history questions, like how long does it take to get foggy? And then ultimately the diagnosis has to be made by seeing the actual debris in the reservoir. And usually, even if patients don't, so the other thing of course is patients will just develop a gradual fogginess after a few hours of wear, so 3 or 4 hours of wear. Then again, you also still have to rule out things like corneal edema, which is usually accompanied by some redness and discomfort. So you usually know. So the question I ask patients is, if you take the lens out, clean the lens, you know, just even rinse the lens, not even a full clean, refill it and put it back in, does it go away? And most of them will say yes. If they say no, then you need to start going down the other routes. The interesting thing too about patient symptoms is I've had a handful, more than once, so a few, probably 10 patients of a lot that have come in and said that they feel like the fluid is coming out of the lens. So they'll say after several hours of wear, the fluid leaks out of the lens. I can feel the fluid leaking out of the lens, and then it gets blurry and there's nothing there. And I look and every time it's midday fogging, which I think is very interesting because it's such a specific symptom. So for patients, if you are experiencing, you know, if the patients are experiencing this, I used to just sort of say, oh, okay, you know, we'll do something else. But then I really started educating them because I want them to understand, like, the fluid is not leaking out of your lens. If the fluid was leaking out of your lens, you'd have a lot bigger problems. But it, you know, it still is frustrating for them. Like, they don't really care what it is. They just want us to fix it. So, you know, and the other things you can, the classic thing that we look at as a reason for the midday fog is just too much clearance. Too much clearance. So like too much fluid thickness, right? So normally we say, hey, maybe you start off with about 300 microns, but inevitably of clearance over the central cornea, but inevitably some patients will have 500 and you still send them home with it and they're still cable. But that's really the one thing where you're kind of like, they might come back with midday fogging. And sometimes they don't, and sometimes they're fine. And sometimes those patients have more clearance than other patients. But then you have the other kind of side of the coin where patients will have only 200 microns at dispense, and maybe it settles down to only 100 microns over the apex, and they still are getting like a thick fog and it's bothering them. So then you have to kind of tick down your troubleshooting kind of list. And there's things that patients should do as well. So it starts with ocular hygiene, and it starts at the level of treating ocular surface disease that the patient might have. So things like morning eye washes, things like using eye wipes, or even just some soft soap and water to really clean the eyelids and lashes.
I know in the practice that I worked at that this was a, you know, we started off finding our way with it, and then Mark, who owns the practice, he now does his best to treat any dryness, any blepharitis, any scaling. He won't even start the fitting until that's finished. Remove the other symptoms, the other problems before we start the fit.
Yeah, I mean, I think that will really pay itself back, because it's not just midday fogging that can cause complications such as, you know, that with blepharitis and that sort of thing. I mean, anybody who's starting to wear a scleral lens, like everything should be done to make the ocular surface and the eyelids as healthy as possible, right? And sometimes there's only so much we can do because their disease dies in the first place. But I always explain to patients two things. One is how clean and healthy your eyes are is going to make a difference in your success with this. And then also how clean you keep the lenses is going to be a success. So it's so important to have everything on the ocular surface as healthy and clean as possible. But you'll still get people who have the midday fogging.
What's your theory on where all this gunge is coming from then? I know I have my own thoughts, but what's your theory?
Yeah, so there's lots of different theories that have been floated. So probably the oldest one is mucin. But we kind of debunked that, actually. So we looked, and it wasn't published, but it was like 5 samples, all with midday fogging, and none of them had any detectable mucin. But what they did have, which was interesting, was lipid. So we found a lot of free cholesterol, which is relatively, it's about 10%, I think, of the lipids in tears naturally. So I thought that was really interesting. And so I think what it ultimately is a combination. So it's not the exact same thing in patient A as it is in patient B. But I think at its core, it's a lipid kind of precipitate that comes out.
It's coming in from outside. It's coming in from under the edge of the lens.
Yeah, so I think, well, maybe. So either yes, or if you have conjunctiva that's under that landing zone, right? It doesn't always land right on that conjunctiva. Even if there's just a half a millimeter of tissue in that area. I believe that's the root. Because you see, if you close down that limbus, so if you close down like the curve over that limbal curve over the cornea, it really reduces the forces, I guess, that kind of pull and suck that debris under. But yeah, I think it's coming from the conjunctiva, and I think it's lipid-based. But that being said, it could be, you know, what we refer to as a glycoprotein, which is a lipid attached to a protein. You've got lots of those, like all over the entire surface of the conjunctiva and cornea, you have these glycolipids. That's job it is to kind of tether the tears against the surface. So when they're not, you know, when they're in this completely different environment and they're covered in saline solution, yeah, is it unreasonable to think that they loosen up and kind of precipitate into the tear film some? I think yes. But again, the lipids are really hard to test for in the tear film, which is why you don't see like, oh, this study just went and looked at it. It's not the most simple process. So
it'll be remedied by amending the fitting, do you think?
Yeah, I think you can do several things to the fit to help. So the first, I kind of start from the center and go to the outside of the lens. So it, you know, decreasing the absolute apical clearance, which honestly doesn't always seem to necessarily do a ton of itself, but it thins out that debris layer. So you're looking through less of a fog. And then that limbal zone, constantly you'll see patients that have midday fogging and they have this lens where like the cornea is like this and it just gets this huge angle of vault over. Yeah. So I think if you bring that down so that you're a little bit more in the actual contour of the eye, which flattens out in that area, that definitely helps. And then finally on the lens landing, you don't want, it's kind of the Goldilocks theory, right? You don't want it to be super tight. We have shown that if it's really tight, that's going to kind of make it worse. And I think it sort of like clogs up the inside and sucks it in. But if it's really loose, the lens will move around and certainly debris will come under. So sometimes doing a toric lens can be helpful. Oftentimes you'll see people switch to some sort of toric lens to maybe make a tight fit just a little bit looser or to make a loose fit just a little bit tighter.
Any practical tips for the practitioners, how they can assess the fit or anything they can do in practice to check for peripheral fit?
So you can do, what I like to do is when the patient comes in, if they have the midday fogging, that's perfect because then you can assess that as well. So after several hours of wear, you can just put fluorescein and I paint it like right onto the conjunctiva. So have them look down so that the fluorescein, you know, kind of goes down around and lets gravity kind of bring it all around the lens. And then see, look for two things. One, look for absolutely no fluorescein coming through, which means you've got like a really tight fit probably, and that could be a problem. Or if you've got a little channel where you're seeing fluorescein come through, watch for that because that's going to let you know if there's tear exchange, if there's not. And I wish I had the perfect answer of what that should look like. But fortunately for our patients, there's a whole wide variety of tear exchange kind of profiles that people will do very well with. So what I usually like to see is no fluorescein going in, like rushing in, but then if I push on the lens just a little bit or have the patient give a couple of forced blinks, then I see just a little bit start to trickle in some areas. And honestly, when I see that, I usually am not seeing midday fogging. But if I see midday fogging, then I'm looking for the relationship and I know probably we need to change that. Or, you know, if it looks really, really good, then maybe it doesn't matter. You know, some patients, even if they have the perfect fit, they're still going to get the midday fogging. So I always kind of encourage practitioners, like, yes, you can look at X, Y, and Z, but don't create a problem where there's, you know, where it's just going to create more of an issue.
Well, obviously, Contamac's a materials company. So any bearing on this with which material you choose? Obviously, you mentioned wetting. Does the material, the decay of the material, have any effect on this, do you think?
No, not anecdotally, but in theory, you know, I might say you could try a higher decay lens in these patients. I don't think we've gotten to a point where people have really played around with that. Certainly not in like an organized clinical study. Yeah. But if you were going to do that study or you were going to look at that, I would hypothesize that a higher DK may have a lower incidence of midday fogging just because you don't have hypoxia. You don't have the same cell processes that are going to happen when you have a slight hypoxic environment. You know, if it's more hypoxic, you might get more, for example, you might get cells secreting more histamine. You might get, you know, cells secreting more. When you create a hypoxic situation or a stressful situation, cells will usually dump out a bunch of stuff and, you know, vasculature dilates. So, but no, I don't know.
You mentioned wettability. Any experience with the Hydropeg system, the Hydropeg surface treatment?
So I've used the Hydropeg some, and we've done some studies with them. you know, I find the hydropeg either really works well or just doesn't work so well, which honestly is okay because it's a coating on the lens, right? So it doesn't change any of the underlying lens properties that I know. So if you, so you have patient A who loves the coating, and I have those patients, and they typically are women, you know, of kind of a certain age, maybe over 40, who have some aqueous deficiency dry eye. I think that is like really the hallmark group for that coating. And I've seen other people and young people do really well. And it's this, you know, hydrophilic coating where it sometimes hasn't worked as well for me as if I have like the opposite, like a bigger man who's got tons of blepharitis and tons of ocular disease, like eye surface disease. And then you just sort of slap on the hydropeg and think it will fix the problem. Well, now you've got this lipophilic coating and MGD all over. So you can actually get more like deposition on the lens and things. So I think, but with those patients, what I haven't tried, which would be interesting, is cleaning, you know, when you really clean up the ocular surface and then introduce hydropeg. I think that's what we said. But like I said, if for some reason you get it in a patient, I've had one patient who had even an allergy to it, but that was, you know, that was one patient, which you're always going to have some patient that has a, you know, doesn't tolerate something. And we just used a super cleaner and cleaned it off and it was fine.
We'll take a break now from this conversation and rejoin Maria at a later date. Thank you for joining us, and if you've enjoyed this video, please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Thank you very much, and look forward to seeing you next time.